Good morning. It's good to see you all on this Lord's Day as we've come together on both Ascension Sunday and also to celebrate our graduates this morning. Let me mention a couple of things to you. First of all, I just want to say for families with children, we hope you're going to stay after worship. We're going to have a picnic event after worship and gather some things together. We're going to think that the clouds are going to keep on going, and we'll have some time to play outside together and just spend some time together after worship. Second thing I wanted to mention to you, this morning we had our second congregational conversation. Our third one will be in 3 weeks on June 11th. This will be the most important one we're going to do, because in the next one we're going to be having you as a congregation to say, what things are you looking for in a new pastor? So we really need you to be here for that one. The format will be different. We'll do that conversation after worship. So please make sure you mark June 11th on your calendar. Beach weekend, another weekend. Mountain weekend, another weekend. Lake weekend, another weekend. June 11th, make sure you're here. After worship, we'll have a box lunch, and then we'll have a conversation together to help the pastor search committee know what they need to do in terms of searching and selecting and bringing a pastor to you sometime in the months ahead. Third thing I want to mention to you is that if you have missed some of these meetings, if you've missed our conversations, I can send you the written questions, and you can answer them and turn them in to me and the pastor search committee, and we will include your insights about our church's past and about our church's present that will help us for our selection process. So please call me, text me, email me if you would like to have a form, and if you have not participated, we will make sure you get those forms and you can fill those questions out and get your feedback back to us. Also, please make sure you notice the personnel committee announcement in there. We are looking for an office manager. So look at that. Talk to your friends, your colleagues, people you know. We want to make sure we have somebody to celebrate and guide this church in that position. I will say, in tag with that, the temporary secretary you have right now keeps on making mistakes in the worship guide. I don't know who you all picked to do that. But the main scripture passage this morning is in Luke 24, not Luke 23. So let's see if next week the person filling in can do that without mistakes. Also want to mention to you that on June the 4th, we're going to begin summer Sunday school, which is going to be in the fellowship hall for youth and adults. We'll have a special youth table that Heather will be guiding in discussion. I'll be leading an overall discussion with everybody to give our adult Sunday school teachers a break. And I'm going to guarantee you this. You will study the Bible in ways you never have before. Who can pass that up? Right? So make sure in 2 weeks you're with us starting at about 9:45 in the fellowship hall. Get a donut or something else we'll have there, and coffee and orange juice, and we'll have Sunday school in the fellowship hall together, youth and adults. And I think that's it. I don't know of anything else to mention to you right now. So let's turn ourselves to God and to our worship as our choir leads us in our call to worship.
Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father and Lord, we come to you today, Lord, again thanking you for your love and your compassion. Lord, as we continue through our service today, be with us, Lord, and open our ears that we can hear your message. Open our hearts, Lord, that we can receive it with love. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the many blessings you give us. and be with our graduates as they go into life and continue their journeys. Lord, we love you and we praise you. Amen.
Let's stand together and worship and sing hymn 308, Glorious is Thy Name. Ask you to be seated. So before we take time to honor our high school graduates, we have some younger graduates that we want to make sure we recognize this morning. So I'm going to ask each of them to come up one at a time. And let's see, who is first? Do you guys know your alphabet yet? Because that's how you come. You come in the order of your alphabet. So first, Cal. Would you come forward? Cal Ainsworth, come on. So Cal, this is an activity book. about Bible characters. And since you are finishing up preschool and soon will be in kindergarten, we want to recognize you and give you something to work on to learn about God. Congratulations, Cal. Thank you so much. Ray, your first name begins with R, which is after a C. That's why your brother got to go before you. So this activity book, we also want you to take time this next year when you're in kindergarten to work through it and learn more about God. Congratulations, Ray. We look forward to having you in kindergarten. Not with us this morning is Risden, and so we will have one of these. We will get that to him. Hanley? Hanley, congratulations. We are so glad that you are finishing up preschool and will be in kindergarten. And we offer this book to you to make sure that you can draw pictures and learn things about some of the characters in the Bible, because we want you to know the Bible so that you will know more about God. Congratulations, Henry. You can go back and see it. This year also, we have four kindergartners who have finished, and they'll be heading to first grade. And while I know that some of our kindergartners are already starting to learn to read, it's really in first grade when you begin really working on reading. And so we're going to offer each of them a Bible from the congregation. So each of them will receive a Bible from the church as they head into reading. As some of you know, some of the stuff in the Bible is beyond first grade reading level, but they will learn it. And this children's Bible has lots of things for them that will help them, answer questions about the Bible for them. And their Sunday school teachers will already start having them just navigating the Bible. So this is a gift, not just for this next year, but also for the years ahead. All right, so, you all know who's first by your alphabet? Charlotte, will you come forward? Charlotte, congratulations on finishing kindergarten. And we are offering this Bible to you from your church family so that you will learn and read about God. Lennon Cook, will you come forward? Lennon, congratulations on finishing kindergarten. We're excited for the summer you're going to have. And we're excited also that as a first grader, you'll be reading, and we want you to read about God and learn about faith in the Bible. Congratulations. Tucker Rose. Congratulations on finishing kindergarten. I know you're going to have a fun summer. And maybe you can start looking through the Bible this summer. Some of the words are big words. They'll be beyond first grade words. But you're going to start knowing about God as you look at it and go to Sunday school. We look forward to growing you in faith. Congratulations. Rivers, congratulations. We're so happy that you're finishing up kindergarten and we'll go to first grade and you'll be a reader. This is your Bible from your church. We hope that you'll be here all the time to learn about God and about Jesus and to grow in faith. Congratulations. Okay. So before we get, in a second, we're going to get you all together, get a little picture. But we did not get a Bible out last year. And so, Holden, would you come forward? You've already been reading. But we want to make sure you have a Bible for the children's Sunday school class in the years ahead. So we want to celebrate that with you. There's your own Bible. Thank you. And will you children come forward? Let's go. Come on up here. Let's get a picture for a couple. We know we have some parents that want pictures. So can you all come on up? Let's come by here. And if you're a parent, come forward quickly and we'll get a picture. Yeah. While we're getting the last pictures in, let's congratulate our young graduates.
All right. The young graduates, if they just sit back with their parents, that's perfectly fine because we've got longer parts of the service now. So you all can go back and sit with your parents. That might be easier. All right, we want to recognize two persons who have been working for 13 years for this moment. And so this morning, where did I put my worship guide? It's down there. So this morning, we also want to recognize graduating from Marlboro College Preparatory Academy, Annalise Kerrigan Chapman. Annalise? And graduating from Anson High School, John Trenton Taylor. So both Annalise and Trent have prepared some remarks for the congregation, so I'm going to ask each of them to come forward. And as they come forward, I'm going to also give them a book that I received in college that was meaningful for me. And since I've been a pastor, I've been handing these books out to high school graduates as they head into college or the military or work. Annalise and Trent, come forward, please.
Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name's Annalise. I've been a member of this church since I was a little girl. This past Friday, I graduated from Marlboro Academy College Preparatory School, and because of all the opportunities the school has given me, I'll be attending East Carolina University in the fall as a part of their Honors College. While there, I'll be pursuing a degree in biology on the pre-med track. My plan is to become a pediatric surgeon after college in medical school, which will hopefully be at Brody School of Medicine at ECU. I've always felt a want to go into the healthcare field, but never quite knew what I wanted to do. These past few years with taking care of my mom and my grandma have made me more sure than ever that healthcare is still the dream, but not in a doctor's office or in a physical therapy building. Sorry. I was talking to my grandma, Matilda, as most of you know her, before she passed, and she was reminding me of when I was younger, how I was always sick, whether it be the stomach flu or a broken bone, especially when I was diagnosed with pre-leukemia. It got me to thinking and researching more into the world of pediatrics to finally get that feeling of excitement of, oh my gosh, this is what I want to do. The surgeon part honestly came from watching years of medical schools, medical shows like Grey's Anatomy. I remember as a little girl sitting in the middle area in the back on the left, sitting right beside her with all of her friends, taking up the first two rows so they could still talk to each other and gossip before it started. And I remember her sitting there and I was listening and her leaning over and saying, this is important, so you better be really paying attention. And then handing me one of the many mints or little butterscotches she kept in her purse. That's how it always has been. I listen and then I would get candy. So if I could remember everything Dr. Hunter or Dr. Workman had said, even as a teenager, thank you for everything this church has done for me, from the Bible school lessons, candy, games, and life lessons, and especially after my grandma passed in January.
Good morning. My name is Trent Taylor, and I'm a 2023 graduate from Anson High School. Graduation is held at Anson High School on May 31st, following the end of the 2022-2023 school year. Following my graduation, I plan to attend South Piedmont Community College this fall to finish up an associate in arts, which will transfer over to a four-year university. Although I'm not 100% sure on the career I would like to pursue, I am leaning towards a land surveying opportunity, which will require me to study at North Carolina A&T. Growing up at First Baptist in Waynesboro is some of my earliest memories. Sunday school at such a young age and VBS every year is a big reason I feel close to God and educated on the wonders of what He can do. And for that, I am grateful. Grateful not only to grow up in such a wonderful setting and place, but grateful to be surrounded by amazing people who set a great example on how to live and act as a child of God. I want to thank this congregation for everything that they have done for me and my family throughout our time in FBC. And once again, thank each and every one of you for all that you do. Thank you.
At the end of the service, we'll be asking the parents to join these graduates at the communion table, and I'll be asking you as a congregation to make sure you come forward to just congratulate all of them on this time in their lives. This is a big moment for both Annalise and Trent. Let's pray together to God. Dear gracious God, we come to you at this time and this moment of lives of we're celebrating these big moments. These big moments for kindergartners going into and coming out of, and for our high school graduates. Both of these are big moments in different points of life. Remind us, O God, that you are with us through all of these journeys that we take. From our young childhood years, when we are just simply youngsters looking up to our parents for guidance. And then going off to school where we meet teachers and lots of friends and we have different people in our lives other than mom and dad. And we grow and learn through all sorts of years and studies until we reach the end of high school. And then we mark the occasion with a great celebration before embarking, before commencing onto a new pathway. Oh God, these are not just the only graduations in life. We have graduations from college. We have graduations from the military honors. We have graduations from one company to another. We have graduations from one vocation to another. We have retirement graduations. Our lives are marked by milestones. We reach them through accomplishments and achievements. But we often have to say goodbye to those and move on to new hellos. This is both an exciting and also a heartbreaking moment. Because it is in our human nature that we want to keep things the same. But you show us on days like today that life never stays the same. We grow up. We grow old. We grow wiser. All of life brings different challenges and changes. And we ask, dear Lord, that your grace, your Holy Spirit, would guide us through all of these. Help us right now, wherever each of us are, whatever challenges we're facing in our lives, whatever struggles we have, we just ask, oh God, that you would guide us through them. We thank you for this church family that walks beside us, that's Jesus with flesh on, that tries to carry the grace and the love of God with a handshake and a hug, with a listening ear. Strengthen us as a church that we may be here for each other through all of the journeys of life, the great excitements and the heartaches. Oh God, we ask that you would forgive us of our sins this week, the ways in which we have fallen short of your glory. Forgive us so that we might be started off tomorrow with a clean slate,
Whatever regrets, whatever problems, whatever mistakes we've made, help us to put them behind us so that we can stand straight and be your people in this world. For Annalise and her classmates who have just graduated, for Trent and his classmates who will soon graduate, we ask that you bless each of them as they celebrate strongly and wonderfully, and then prepare for the next steps in their lives. Prepare them, prepare their parents and family. Prepare each of us for the next steps of our lives, because all of us are graduating from time to time, from one challenge, from one job, from one moment to the next. Help us to be resurrection people. People who not just celebrate Easter, but who celebrate the fact that you resurrect our lives over and over again when we come to dead ends and when we complete our jobs and start us on new pathways. All these things, O God, we give you thanks for your grace. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. All right, our youngsters, come on forward.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you. And all of you graduates that got your Bibles, I can't wait for you to read to me. So any Sunday that you want to come in here, or any time during the week, call me up and say, "Miss Dolores, I want to read you a Bible verse." And then we eventually will graduate where we'll let you come in and read with us on Sunday morning. Won't that be fun? Oh, gracious. One escaped. That's okay. This morning, we're going to read from Acts. And we're going to talk about a lady that you may not have heard of before. And her name is Dorcas. Strange name. But Dorcas was a lady who lived in and around the Jerusalem area, and she was known for, yes, here are my shoes. Yes, Craven, and you got them shoes too. Any time that she saw anybody who didn't have a coat, who didn't have a dress, needed some clothes, she would go make the clothes for them and give them to them. And that was her ministry. Her ministry was taking care of people who needed to be taken care of, and particularly in making clothes and doing what the children needed. Children, adults, it didn't matter, but Dorcas. And we find Dorcas's story in Acts, starting in chapter 10. And now that you have Bibles, I want you all to go home and find that scripture in your new Bibles, and you can read the story that I'm going to tell you this morning. But Dorcas had a tragedy and died. And the people started crying, and they said, "What are we going to do? She makes all of our clothes and gives them to us, and she takes care of us." They called Peter to come in, and he did, and he said, "Just close the door." He went in with her, and he started praying, and she came back alive. And they said, "Peter, you did such wonderful work." And he said, "It was not me. It was God who did that." So we see that Dorcas was brought back alive because that's what Jesus wanted and God wanted at that point in time. The Bible tells us about many people, and there are many characters in the Bible that have good stories. And this is one about giving and giving freely. Dorcas was one of the ones who saw a need and gave it. Now, I don't think I could make clothes for anybody. So Dorcas, that was her gift and something that she could do. But Dorcas, the story of Dorcas this morning is telling us that we all need to find something we can do to give to somebody else. Sometimes it may be a friend who is down and you just put your arm around him and say good morning. Or somebody needs somebody to play with and go on the playground with them. Find a way for the people around you that you can tell them that you care. That's showing God's love wherever you are. And that, yes, God, yes, or whatever Craven is saying, it doesn't matter. Yes. So Dorcas was a character in the Bible that gives us a lot to think about and a lot to consume and know what we can do. So we too can look around and see what we can do for the people around us. And there's always somebody who needs something. It may be a smile, it may be a hug, it may be a good morning. And think about the people who would just love to have somebody speak to them. Just let Craven go where Craven wants to go. There are plenty of people in this church who can take care of him. He's fine. He's fine. Tell Mama to go sit. See, Mama's over there. He may end up in the choir. Yes. You're going, oh, you want to sit with me? That's okay. That's okay. So we see that we need to look for what it is God wants us to do, because he's given all of us an opportunity to do wonderful things. Right, Rivers. You've got a lot to teach him, darling. You know, he's going to be a good student, right? Yes. Yes. Don't y'all love to hear that noise? I don't know about y'all, but I love to hear the noise of children in church. So, and they can do no wrong, as Ashley knows that that's my theory, that they are all right, whatever they're doing. So Dorcas was one of those characters that we don't read a lot about. But she had her own ministry, and even though she did not have a lot of money and it didn't take a lot of money, she would take rags and make dresses or coats for people who needed them. So what we can learn from Dorcas this morning is that she always cared about her friends. She cared about the people who were around her. And she always remembered to pray. And to her, prayer was one of the most important things. So this morning, those of you who got your Bibles, now you have something to go home and read. And I can't wait for you to tell me the stories, that your favorite story that you've read so far in your Bible. Because I do want you to read them. I do want you to read your Bibles. We see that friends are important. We see that family is important. And most of all, God is important. And he's the most important one. If we listen to him every day, he will guide us and tell us what direction he wants us to go in. Let's pray. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for the beauty of this day, and we thank you for our graduates. And special blessing for Trent and Annalise as they are going into a new adventure. And for all of our little ones that we have up here, Lord, we thank you that you've given them to us for us to teach them. And we take our job seriously. So, Lord, we thank you for this day and bless all these children as they learn your word. Learn as they learn to read your Bible and what beauty it has and what blessings it has. So, Lord, we thank you for your many blessings and for giving us the opportunity. In thy wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Our main scripture passage this morning comes from the 24th chapter in Luke, beginning with verse 44. Then Jesus said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power on high." Then he led them out as far as Bethany, and lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he was blessing them, he withdrew from them and was carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy. And they were continually in the temple, blessing God. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May it be for our blessing and understanding. Let's stand together while we sing together the doxology.
When I am down, and oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come, and my heart burdened be, then I am still, and wait here in the silence, until you and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. There is no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, Sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be.
The story of Jesus' ascension into heaven leaves a key question unanswered. Why did he leave? I posed this question to you in my first sermon with you back in February, and I want to circle back around for another perspective. Luke tells us in the first sentences of his second book, the book of Acts, that for 40 days, Jesus kept ministering and serving as the resurrected Lord following Easter morning. Then he gathered his disciples together on a mountain, according to Matthew. Luke just says that they went away as far as Bethany. Bethany is about a couple miles from the center of Jerusalem. And it is on the east slope of the Mount of Olives. So perhaps this is the mountain they were on, according to Matthew. There Jesus blessed them and ascended into heaven. And as far as his bodily presence has been gone ever since. Which pushes the question. Why did he leave? Why didn't the resurrected Jesus just stay on earth? Why didn't the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords rule on earth rather than to rule in the heavens? Why didn't the Prince of Peace stay and bring peace on earth between nations and peoples and tribes? If Jesus had just stayed on earth for a few more decades, then perhaps he could have kept the Romans from destroying Jerusalem in 70 AD and pushing the Jewish people away from Jerusalem and the Palestine area. Perhaps then they could have stayed. And then maybe centuries later, the Holocaust would never have happened. Or perhaps if Jesus was stayed a few more decades, he might have removed slavery from the Roman Empire and taught the people the evilness of slavery
And then European people centuries later would not have invaded Africa and began the tragic Middle Passage and captured Africans and instituted the evil of slavery into North America, which still plagues our society today. Why did Jesus leave? Why did he ascend into heaven, leaving us to fend for ourselves? This year, Ascension Sunday falls on the day when First Baptist celebrates the achievements of our graduates, in particular, the hard work that Annalise and Trent and their classmates have mastered over the course of 13 years, beginning in kindergarten, like the youngsters we had here who just slipped out to children's church a moment ago. There may have been a moment for Lisa and Brad and Michael and Tanja when they saw the kindergartners and looked at their own children and wondered, where did the time go so quickly? This past week, I've been thinking about that because we were on vacation as a family, and I was together with my three children for the first time since Christmas, and that really wasn't much of a gathering because both I and one of my daughters had COVID, so we did not really have a big celebration then. So it's the first time in a long time my wife and I have had all of our kids together. 6 years removed from this day for Trent and Annalise. I can't remember whether I cried more on my kids' high school graduation day or on their first day of kindergarten. Just know I cried at both, because I knew that a piece of our life together would never be the same. When your kids go off to kindergarten, they are really out of your care for most of a day with adults that you trust, teachers in our community. When they leave high school, they head off to a new horizon, and they are their own persons. This past week, while I was on vacation, it reminded me, as we talked about stories around the dinner table and card table, about old memories. And those will always be with me in that numinous way that memories are. But as my wife and I said goodbye to each of our kids this week, we also knew we are in a new life, a new stage. So I think it's appropriate that we celebrate both these occasions today, Trent and Annalise's graduation and Jesus' ascension, because both mark the reality that time passes and things cannot remain the same indefinitely, even for the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Trent and Annalise, you have reached a precipice in your life. You have climbed a mountain path after years of study, and you've reached a summit. So look around as you do when you reach a summit, right? Because you can choose to go in so many different directions. As you can see when you're on a mountainside, and can see all the things that are out there. This may seem overwhelming. So many ways, so many pathways you could take. But don't let that worry you. You do not have to have the next 20 of your years of your life all worked out ahead of time. So take some of the pressure off. Your future success is not going to hinge on whether you selected the right major or the right college or the right job in the future, or the right person to fall in love with. You're going to have lots of decisions to contemplate and to evaluate in the next few months and the next few years. But no single one of those is going to make the difference. It's a collection of all those decisions and a collection of all the relationships that you have had in your life that mean so much to you, and the relationships that you're going to have that will mean so much to you. And all of those together mix in together, and in that mixture, you will work things out. So, take a deep breath and relax and enjoy this opportunity you have. You have graduated or about to graduate from high school. You have reached this pinnacle from a mixture of hard work and creative Sabbath time, of lessons learned and sometimes relearned, mistakes corrected, broken hearts mended, and bridges rebuilt. And you have reached the next summit with a similar mixture of all of those again, and the one after that, and the one after that, right, everybody? Because while you are celebrating your high school graduation, this is not the end of your education. You're on a pathway in which you are always going to be learning, whether it is through formal education or through the education of a life lived. The key on these pathways of climbing the next mountain, the next life challenge, is naming your purpose for the journey. Knowing the purpose of your journey. Now, you've been on a pathway, a journey for the last 13 years, and a few more onto that before you went to kindergarten, of more or less trying to largely please the adults in your life, right? Your parents, your teachers, authority figures, all these people who have been saying to you, you need to learn this. This is what you need to learn. And you've been pretty good at it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here in these robes today. Now your purpose will shift dramatically and largely be created by you, not by your parents or your professors or even your future bosses at work. What do you want to do with this life that God has gifted you? It is a gift. Treat it as one. Who really is Trent Taylor? Who really is Annalise Chapman? And how will you begin exploring this human and spiritual and temporal journey? Your purpose in the next few years is to begin figuring that out. I envy you. It is a wondrous and exciting journey. Jesus completed his purpose in serving the world as God's Messiah, as the incarnation of God's dwelling in flesh and blood, and therefore it was time for him to graduate. For Jesus to move on to the next phase of his divine existence, the next challenge, the next journey. When your purpose is completed, it's time to graduate. It's time to celebrate the best ways you know how, and then to move on to the next challenge that God has for you. This is true not just for Trent and Annalise. It's true for the youngsters that we gave out Bibles and Bible activity books today. But it's true for all of us here. There's always going to be a next challenge. There's always going to be things that you have accomplished in life, achieved in life, and they're completed, they're done. And then there's going to be the next challenge. And at each precipice in our lives, when we have reached the summit, it's then time for us to look around and to talk to God about this. What's the next challenge? What's the next journey? And in doing that, we have to work on between us and God, what will our purpose be in that?
There's always going to be a next job, a next vocation. Some of us move from job to job. Some of us realize we need to change our vocations and go to something else. Some of us reach to a point of retirement and then have to figure out, what is my purpose now? Now that I don't have to work for a paycheck and have somebody tell me what I have to do. What's my purpose with this gift that God has given me? What is my purpose now? All of us have to be working that out. What is my purpose now? And we complete that and graduate. We look around and we say, God, what do you have for me next? This is true not for all of us, but for Jesus Christ as well. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When your purpose is completed, it's time to graduate and to celebrate and then to look at your vantage point and determine where God is calling you next. Jesus did not leave us alone on Ascension Day. How did he say it? And see, I'm sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Jesus could graduate because God believed that the Holy Spirit with the Christian church could do Jesus' work on earth. Trent and Annalise, we can celebrate your graduation because your parents and this congregation and the God who knew you before your parents were even born believes in you and in this wondrous journey on which you're about to commence. Commencement, it's what we call graduation services, but commence means to begin, to embark, to start. This is not an ending we're marking. This is a beginning we are launching you onto. Each of us, and this church as well, can graduate from one precipice to the next because the Holy Spirit is always there to direct us from one celebration of one accomplishment to one commencement of the next journey. We are resurrection people, after all, are we not? Through laughters and through tears, through goodbyes and through hellos. May the commencement begin. Amen. It is at this time in our worship service, when we come to an end in the Baptist tradition, we invite you, if you have loved God, but you've never made a commitment to Jesus Christ, we invite you to come forward and say, I want to be baptized. I want to claim Jesus as my own. Or if you've been a Christian for a long time and you're looking for a new church home, I've been here long enough to tell you, this ain't a perfect church. I'll just tell you right off the bat. But it is a church that generally tries to love God and to love each other. And I would commend this congregation to you. Whatever decision you have, we invite you to come forward. With the last stanza this morning, I'll ask Trent and Annalise to come forward and their parents so that afterwards you may greet them and celebrate this moment with them. Let's stand together as we sing hymn number 313, Take the Name of Jesus With You. So, what a great day together in worship. We're so glad that we've had this chance to be with our graduates and to mark this special day in their lives. We're excited for them and for their children as they head on to a commencement, a new beginning. So for Trent and Annalise, we're so pleased for you. Afterwards, at benediction, if y'all will come forward and greet them and make sure you help the families out getting pictures. Delaney's already got her camera ready. And before you guys leave, I want to get a picture with you two graduates, so make sure we do that too. So, let's see. Am I forgetting anything else? Janine, am I forgetting anything? Just had this aching feeling I'd forgotten something. Oh, well. Let's receive the benediction, and then I'll invite all of you all to come forward and greet our graduates. Friends, as you go back out into the world, do justice and love kindness and walk humbly with God. And may the God of creation prepare every step of your way, and may Jesus Christ walk beside of you, and may the Holy Spirit wrap God's love around you and protect you from all things. Friends, go in peace. Amen.